Hey guys, this is Josh here with Trillium Wild Edibles, and these white flowers you're looking at are yarrow. This is an extremely beautiful summertime plant. This plant's kind of hard for people to find. The main reason is because it's very inconspicuous. You usually don't even notice it. One of the best ways to notice yarrow is those very bright white flowers. They stick out very well the time of year that yarrow usually blooms. In my area, yarrow usually flowers. Usually starting at the middle of May, and it'll flower all the way until September in my area, and I live in Indiana, so that should kind of give you an idea of when yarrow will flower in your area. There are a lot of different varieties of yarrow. The wild kind, like you see here, is going to have a white flower. Usually people grow this ornamentally at their house, and you'll see all kinds of different colors like pinks and reds and blues and such. You might even see some white within those as well. I don't know if those have the same uses medicinally, however, they are a form of yarrow, but for safety, it's best to go ahead and use the wild version of yarrow like you see here, this beautiful white-flowered version. Anywhere you find one yarrow plant, you're most likely going to find some more. For example, if we take a look at the ground around us right now, we're going to notice a whole bunch of yarrow leaves. And you can see some small yarrow plants here getting ready to bud and start flowering. Can see more of these leaves here. If we look back here, we can see another plant getting ready to start flowering soon. Yarrow has very distinct leaves. The leaves are very finely cut, and you'll notice all these little bitty leaflets running down the stem. Now in your field guides, you're going to be kind of warned about the differences between yarrow and Queen Anne's lace and hemlock, and some of your field guides are going to warn you against using yarrow or Queen Anne's lace if you're a beginner forager. And in my opinion, I don't really quite understand that logic. It's good that they're doing it and trying to keep you to be safe, but poison hemlock doesn't really look anything like yarrow in my opinion. Yarrow's leaves, as you can see, are very fine, very delicate. They have superbly deep cuts. You can see just how delicate these leaves really are. I call these leaves lacy because to me they remind me of like Victorian lace. They're very fine and almost fringe-like. Yarrow has a really nice growth pattern in the sense that the leaves all grow alternating of each other. You'll notice that the leaves alternate all the way up this plant. The stem of yarrow is rather fuzzy. It's kind of stiff and almost woody, if you will. Here you might be able to see the fuzz on the stem. It kind of resembles like a woolly covering, if you will. It kind of makes the stem feel, It makes the stem of the plant feel kind of soft to the touch, which is really nice. Yarrow can grow to varying heights. You will find yarrow plants all the way up to 3 feet tall. You can see like this one here, this one's about 3 feet tall. I usually don't find them getting much larger than this in my area, though you might where you live. You can see this little smaller one here growing up that's getting ready to start flowering. And as this plant grows, it's going to continue to grow a little taller and taller until it reaches its end size, which is only maybe another foot and a half maybe for this one. Yarrow has a long history of uses all across the world dating back several thousands of years. The plant is named after its supposed discoverer, Achilles. Its Latin name is Achillea millefolium. And it, like I said, it derives that name from Achilles, its supposed discoverer, who was said to have used yarrow on his troops to heal sword gashes and sword wounds. That's one of the many properties of this plant, or one of the many benefits of this plant, is that you can use it as a pain reliever. You can use it to stitch up wounds, so to speak. The plant is such a good astringent, it'll contract the skin so much that it'll actually help seal up rather deep wounds. Plant not also heals pain, but it's also anti-inflammatory. It's also antibacterial, so while at the same time you're healing your cut, you're cleaning it out, and you're reducing swelling anywhere near the trauma area. So that's a really good benefit to this plant. As far as using yarrow, you can use the entire herb. The entire above ground part of the plant is supposed to be used. You can use the stems, the leaves, the flowers, and the flower buds. Another good thing about yarrow is you can use it any time of the year that you find it growing. You know, so if in the early spring all you find are these leaves, just gather up several of them and you can go ahead and use those to make yourself a yarrow tea. You can use those to make tincture. You can use those as a poultice, if you will. You can use these for several different things. You can use them for salves or balms even. You can even use it in shampoos and soaps. You can use yarrow for a number of things. A quick note of caution, though, with yarrow. Yarrow does contain thujone. The fresh plant contains the most thujone. After it's dried, the thujone is released. Thujone is known as the active compound within absinthe. Thujone exists in very large quantities in plants like wormwood as well. And those kind of plants are known because of their effects. Thujone can kind of make you feel really drunk. And it can, if you take too much, make you hallucinate. So that's something to keep in mind. So whenever you make your yarrow tea or your yarrow tincture, it's a good idea to use a dried plant. However, using some of the fresh plant won't hurt too much because the thujone and yarrow will get dissolved by steeping it in hot water. So that's something else to keep in mind. Unfortunately though, yarrow is rather bitter in taste, so if you make a tea out of it, kind of be cautious of that. Yarrow does have its own distinct smell, though in my opinion it's really hard to describe. It's very aromatic when you smell it, kind of smelling almost like some sort of perfume. There's an astringency to it, or like a tannic smell. I don't think this plant actually has tannins, but it reminds me of the smell of whenever I'm leaching acorns. So if you've ever leached acorns, you might know what that smells like. But it smells very, very good whenever you crush the flowers or the leaves or even the stem. You can crush any part of the plant in your fingers, crush it and rub it between your fingers and take a smell. And you're going to smell this really aromatic smell that, like I said, is really hard to describe. You have to find this plant and smell it. Then you'll know what I'm talking about. Today I wanted to show you the differences between yarrow, Queen Anne's lace, and poison hemlock. If you look in your field guides, you will notice a warning about using these plants, saying that beginners should be cautious to avoid misidentification. In my opinion though, they look nothing alike, and this video shows you how different these plants really look. And like I said earlier, in your field guides, they'll warn you about using yarrow because you might confuse it with Queen Anne's lace or poison hemlock. And you might be able to see what I'm talking about here. This is Queen Anne's lace. These leaves look nothing like yarrow leaves. They do look similar in a drawing, in a line drawing, and I guess that's probably why in the Peterson Field Guide they say that, because it's really hard to determine the technical details of the leaves through those line drawings. But in real life, up close and personal with these plants, you're really going to be able to see the differences. Queen Anne's lace, its leaves are so much larger. They're not near as finely cut. There's just really no way to confuse these two. So there's the leaves of Queen Anne's lace, and here are the leaves of yarrow. I mean, you could say that yarrow leaves look like feathers. Those, the ground rosettes of them here certainly resemble feathers, in my opinion. They even feel like feathers. They're very light, one touch, and they move real easy. Whereas the Queen Anne's lace have more weight to them because they're larger. These leaflets are much larger. They're not near as finely dissected. So this plant has more mass. Doesn't feel near like a feather, and it doesn't look at all like a feather. Also, the stem of Queen Anne's lace has these hairs running up and down it. Whereas yarrow, as you can see here, has this almost woolly-like covering instead of those little fine hairs. So those are just a couple of the quick differences between yarrow and Queen Anne's lace. And here you guys can see poison hemlock. Here you can see these white flowers with 5 petals. And here you can see the shape of these leaves. You can see what I mean, how these leaves look nothing like yarrow, and they look nothing like Queen Anne's lace. Queen Anne's lace's leaves are a lot more finely dissected. Yarrow's leaves are even finer than hemlock and Queen Anne's lace, and there are a lot more leaflets on yarrow than there are on hemlock and Queen Anne's lace. But here you can see the distinct shape on these leaves. You can see just how big these leaves are in comparison to Queen Anne's lace or yarrow. So that's something to keep in mind, and that's something I wanted to show you guys, so that way you don't pick the wrong plant and you don't poison yourselves. Also, the stem of poison hemlock, as you can see here, has all of these purple splotches on it, whereas Queen Anne's lace and yarrow has neither of those. You can see just how big the stem on poison hemlock gets. This plant gets absolutely huge. Here you can see this plant here. This plant's taller than I am. This plant's at least 6, 6.5 feet, maybe even 7 right now. Also, the growing environment. I usually never find Queen Anne's lace or yarrow next to hemlock, because I usually always find hemlock, as you can see here on the edge of fields. Sorry about the noise, we're doing some tree work down the road. But this is where I always find hemlock. I never find it anywhere near yarrow. Now you may be different. I wanted to do an identification video on this medicinal plant called Canadian Sanicle. The plant you're looking at is called Canadian Sanicle. There are several varieties of this plant, and usually determining one from another is going to be very difficult by collectors. The reason being, these plants are usually separated by technical details that are most determined in a lab setting. So determining one from another is going to be very difficult. However, the good thing is, almost all of them are used interchangeably. One thing you may notice about this plant is this extremely small umbel or cluster of yellow to greenish flowers here. These flowers can be any color from yellow, green, all the way to white. So that's something to kind of keep in mind, is that you can see various colors throughout this plant on its flowers. This plant has 3 to 5 leaflets on the lower leaves. You're going to notice 5 leaflets on the leaf coming out of the petiole. These leaves are lance-shaped and they are toothed, and you'll note that they have these kind of lobe-like teeth here where my thumb is and here by my ring finger. And you may also notice these serrations or these teeth running down the margins or the edges of the leaf. The lower leaves of the plant are going to be growing out of this very long leaf stem that you see here, whereas the top leaves of the plant just grow right out of the main stalk. They don't have really a stem that they attach to that attaches to the stalk. So that's something else to kind of keep in mind. Also, as you get further up the plant, the top sets of leaves are only going to have 3 leaflets. And again, they are going to be toothed with various types of lobes. And you may be able to see here how small these top leaflets can actually get. They can get pretty small. And they get smaller as you go up the plant. So that's something to keep in mind. This plant can grow to several heights. I usually only find it growing to about 2 feet high in my area. Where it grows, it usually likes to cover an entire area, so that's one of the good things about it. You may be able to see all of this sanicle here growing along the edge of this road. And if we go back over here, we can see even more of this sanicle. But here's more of this sanicle so you guys can see what I'm talking about on how thick this stuff really does grow. I mean, this stuff is everywhere. Whenever you find it, you're going to see a lot of it. I bet a lot of you probably see this all the time and maybe wonder what it is. Now you guys know what it is. Like I said, you can find it anywhere in moist woodlands. This plant is just prolific, as can be. But here you can kind of get an idea of the type of woodland environment that I'm in here. Got a lot of spice bush around in the area. Got a lot of poplars, a lot of maple, got ash. And then right on the other side, we've got some pines, good mixed deciduous trees. This plant has a lot of awesome uses. I usually like to use the leaves mainly in poultices for bruises or cuts or any kind of inflammation. You can also take the whole plant and you can crush it or macerate it in your hands. And then you can put it in hot bath water with plantain. And that'll help to relieve the pain of sore muscles. It'll also help to relieve bone or joint pains like rheumatic pains or rheumatic complaints. It'll help to relax the tendons. It'll help to relax the body. Like I said, it helps to relieve pain. It's anti-inflammatory. And that's one of the really, really good things about this plant. I don't know if you guys can see the scar that's left on the tip of my thumb, but I had a really bad cut there about 1.5 years ago. And I had used Canadian Sanicle on it because I was in the woods when this cut happened. I didn't have anything else on me to help relieve the pain or stop the inflammation. It was pretty bad. There was actually blood squirting out. I actually had to kind of tourniquet up my thumb with my shirt at the time and some Bankline because it was all I had on hand. It was a really bad cut. If it wasn't for this plant, I would have been in excruciating pain on the drive home. It was really bad. And it's because of this plant that I wasn't in pain. And I use this plant. I tell people about this plant all the time whenever they have muscle pains or joint pains or rheumatic complaints. This plant, along with plantain, is amazing for those kinds of things. If you look in your field guide, it won't really talk a lot about that, but if you read the Indian Herbology of North America by Alma R. Hutchins, she does talk about that use, about the use of sanicle for inflammation and pain. So that's something to kind of keep in mind, is that whenever you're reading different sources, sometimes you're going to see different things. A lot of different plants, medicinally and edibly, have a lot of uses. They have a lot of variations in uses, and there are a lot of different ways that you can use plants, just like there are a lot of variations within the plants themselves sometimes. So I'm out here doing a little foraging today, and the plant you're looking at is Canadian wood nettle. There are a couple of ways that you can tell this. First and foremost is these very distinct leaves. These leaves are oval, or in my opinion, teardrop shape, because they have this point here. All along the sides or the margins of the leaves, you'll notice these teeth. You may also notice the texture on this leaf and the vein structure on this leaf and how the veins all run parallel to each other. The top of the leaves have these little fuzz, which is responsible for the stinging. The entire plant is covered in these little stinging hairs. Here you may be able to see these stinging hairs running down the stem. Now this plant does flower, but obviously it's way too early for the flower because these plants are just coming up. And this is one of the best times to eat nettles or gather their greens, is right whenever they're young. The reason being, they have the best taste and they actually have just slightly less sting, in my opinion. Canadian wood nettle can be used the same way as stinging nettle. You can use these young leaves as a cooked green, or you can dry them and you can make a delicious tea out of them as well. This plant is also medicinal, and this plant is purportedly better and stronger than regular stinging nettle. Another really good thing about this plant is its growth pattern. Wherever you find one, you are going to find a hell of a lot more. Excuse my language, but you really are. And I'll show you what I mean here. Here you can see all these young little bitty nettles. You can see a white violet growing. Sorry about that, I had to smack a fly off the camera. There you can see a white violet growing in, very beautiful. And here you can see another really good patch of nettles. As far as the type of areas that wood nettle likes to grow, obviously it likes woods, but you're going to find this near moist areas. As you can see, I'm right here by a creek. I always find wood nettle by creeks. I never find it up much higher than creeks, unless there just happens to be a lot of runoff, or maybe a spring in the area. Usually though, I find it in areas, good Lord, flies! You're gonna see flies all over my arm here, I'm sorry guy. You're gonna see flies all over my arm, I'm sorry. But as you can see here, the land is really low and it's really moist. And this is the kind of place, like I said, that you're going to find that Canadian wood nettle. It absolutely loves these kinds of environments. Other plants you may find nearby are bluebells like this one here. Extremely beautiful flowers. This plant has extremely beautiful flowers, just like you can see. And they too grow in large patches as well. Because of this plant's stinging hairs, I would recommend that you wear gloves while harvesting it. Reason being, your hands are going to be on fire if you don't. Thankfully though, water, especially cold water, is a really good way to relieve the itch of stinging nettles. Also, jewelweed works just as good too. So does plantain leaf, if you can find any of that. So those are kind of just some things to keep in mind in case you get stung by this plant and you're wondering how on earth you get rid of it. That's the easiest way, next to time, and suffer. Mind you, I'm not wearing any gloves. The reason for that is just so you guys can see what it is I'm doing as I harvest this. To harvest Canadian wood nettle, what I like to do is, you can see these nodes right here. Yeah, you're probably going to see some flies on me. But I like to just go to that node, just like that. I always leave two leaves on the plant because it won't kill it. This plant will actually continue to grow out. It'll also grow more nodes, which is really nice because it increases the harvest later. And when you're done, this is what you've got. Now as these cook down, they obviously reduce a good bit. They reduce a lot like spinach does. So you need a lot of fresh greens to make cooked greens. But they're extremely delicious. They're really high in protein. But they're extremely delicious and they're really high in protein. So they're definitely worth eating. I don't know if you guys can see all of these flies. This is how many flies there are today. This is how bad they are today, man. I've just been getting literally swarmed and covered. I mean, I can't not be covered in flies. This is insane. today, I wanted to go over the identification and uses of the white pine. Whether it's a sap for medicine, its bark for food, or even its needles for tea, this is one of the most important plants to know if you're interested in foraging.
The easiest way to tell if you have a white pine is to find one of the branches. And then once you do that, find a section of the needles like you can see I have back here. And then what you want to do is you want to count them. And whenever you count them, you should find 5 needles. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now the pine tree is like a supermarket of the forest. You can use these needles as a tea, and they're really rich in vitamins A and C. They also taste delicious. They have more vitamin C than orange juice, so that's something to keep in mind. And they're also really good for boosting the immune system just because of the amount of vitamin C that they have within them. The bright young green needles in the spring are going to taste the best for tea. However, you can use any needle that you want on the tree. Now granted, this pine tree doesn't have any cones on it, but when it does, the small little cones will be coming out of the ends of the stems here. And now the young male cones, whenever they're young and firm and green, can be boiled and eaten somewhat like a vegetable. It may not taste the greatest, but it is subsistence food in a desperate time. Here we can see a little bit of sap exuding from the bark of this pine tree. And the sap of the pine tree actually has a whole lot of uses as well, believe it or not. Not only can the sap be combined with charcoal and dried grass to make pitch glue, it can also be put on cuts to help seal up the wounds. It also acts as an antiseptic and antibacterial. You can also put it on splinters. It'll help to draw out splinters as well. Many people may not be aware, though, that the inner bark of the pine tree is also edible. You can see how whenever I lift this up with my finger and I'm going very slow, you can see that darker brown. You can see the actual wood starting to become exposed there. That's how you can tell the difference between the inner cambium layer and the start of true wood. We can just peel this off, just like that. And you take it, you can eat it raw as it is. It's not going to hurt you in any way. It's very piney in taste, of course. You can also take this inner cambium layer of bark and you can dry it out and ground it into a flour. Now, obviously that flour is going to be very piney in taste, and it would be best to mix it with any of your regular flour to make sort of like a flour extender. However, it's definitely something to keep in mind. There are actually tribes in the Northeast in New York and Maine that actually lived off of the inner bark of the pine tree during the winter. So you can use the inner bark of this pine tree for subsistence food if you have nothing else. These plants that you see in front of you are bloodroot. There are a couple of ways that you can tell this. First and foremost, you're going to notice the straight up growing leaf with 6 lobes. And on each lobe, you're going to notice these rounded teeth-like lobes. And you're going to see a lot of variation. You can see a different leaf here. These leaves always grow straight up, and there's only one leaf on each plant. You'll also note this extremely beautiful white flower. This is the time of year when the flowers start losing their petals because it's an extremely early spring flower. It's one of the earliest spring flowers that we have in the eastern woodlands. Usually on these flowers, you're going to notice anywhere from 7 to 10 petals. However, like I said, usually within a couple days after flowering, they already start dropping their petals. You can see this one's dropping its petals now. And this is what they're going to look like before the flowers even open, which they look pretty cool and they look beautiful here. They look kind of like a white buttercup. And you can see this extremely small bloodroot leaf here. You can see how I just touched it and the petals just fell off. That's not a big deal. That's not me harming or killing or destroying the plant in any way. This is just natural this time of year. Any light touch, these petals are going to start falling off. Like I said, these flowers only bloom for 1 to 2 days, and that's it. However, these leaves will remain for a good portion of the growing season, so that's good. So as long as you spot these leaves, you know you found some bloodroot. This plant isn't edible. It is medicinal, though I would not recommend using it internally unless you are prescribed it by a doctor or physician or homeopathist or something of that sort. The reason for that being, this root contains sanguinarine, which is said to cause glaucoma. This plant's root is very shallow. It doesn't take very much effort to get to. Usually you can get away with just using your finger.
And here you can see why it's called bloodroot, and the reason for that is whenever you damage or cut the root, it's going to spit out this red juice that's similar to blood. This red juice was traditionally used by Native Americans in the eastern woodlands as a red skin dye or a red skin paint. You can also use it to dye textiles as well if you so choose to go through all that effort. However, I wouldn't recommend doing it only because this plant's so beautiful. I wouldn't recommend tearing it up. It does have medicinal uses, but like I said, I'm not going to go into any of that because this plant can be extremely dangerous, and this plant can cause glaucoma according to some reports and some studies, and it's just because of the amount of sanguinarine that is in this root. But if I take this red portion of the root and rub it on my skin, you're going to notice this red stain. And as you can see, it would take quite a bit of this to make red skin dye or red skin paint. So again, it's not something I would recommend doing. However, this root does have an external medical use that I will talk about, and that is supposedly it's good for removing warts. I haven't used it for that, mainly because I usually use dandelion or wild lettuce or milkweed sap. However, you can apply this red juice to a wart, and it's said to remove them. Again, I don't know if that works or not, because I haven't tried it. So I'm out here doing a little hike today, doing a little bit of scouting. The plant that you see in front of you is cut-leaf toothwort. There are a couple ways that you can tell this. First and foremost, you'll notice these white flowers with four petals. The petals are kind of long, as you can see here. Cut-leaf toothwort has a palmate leaf structure. As you'll notice here, the leaves are kind of like a palm. The reason it's called cut-leaf toothwort is because the leaves are very deeply cut, just like you can see here. And you'll also notice that the leaves have these little bitty teeth on them. And whenever you look at the leaves, you're going to notice three leaflets. It looks like there's five, maybe even seven. However, there's actually only three. You've got this middle one, and then you've got these two ends. If you look carefully around anywhere you find cut-leaf toothwort, you're probably going to be finding more. The reason for that is it's a colonizing plant. A lot of the early spring wild edibles and plants in general are colonizing. And here next to this cut-leaf toothwort, you can see some more spring beauties. Here on these flowers, you'll notice these little stripes, which you may not have seen in the other spring beauty. There are some slight variations in the flowers of spring beauty, just like there are some variations within most plants. Cut-leaf toothwort is edible. It's the root that you're after, or the rhizome, which you can see this rhizome here. I'm not going to tear this plant up. However, you can see it right there. They're very, very shallow, so that's really nice. You don't usually need a trowel to even get to these, and you don't really need too much. You can take this little bitty rhizome here, and you can actually crush it up, and you can use it as a horseradish substitute if you really want to. It tastes delicious, and it tastes just like horseradish. It's got a good, mild, spicy flavor. It's very delicious, very juicy. And like I said, it really only takes a couple to make a decent amount of horseradish for a couple number of people. So you really won't have to do a whole lot of work to get to these. But I thought I would show you this. But there you may be able to see how much dirt I had to remove. I didn't really have to remove a lot. So this is kind of nice, and these are one plant that doesn't take a lot of work to get to. However, you're not going to get a lot of calories from it either, so it's kind of a give and take relationship. Cover this back up with its layer of soil and humus here and leaves. This little flower that you see in front of you is a Carolina Spring Beauty. There are a couple of ways that you can tell this. First and foremost, this very, very slender stalk and these very narrow, drooping, almost hanging leaves. See, these leaves are very narrow, they're long, they come to a very fine point at the end. You'll also note that the leaves grow opposite and there are only two sets of leaves on the stem. You can see another young one coming up here, and this is what you're going to see when they first start coming up, is you're going to see one leaf. You can see here there are more flower buds. And you'll also notice this extremely beautiful white flower with 5 petals. And you'll also notice at the ends of the pistils in the flower, there's these little bitty pink speck-like things. Now this flower has a pinkish hue to it, and it may be kind of hard to see because of the lighting. However, it's kind of pink and white at the same time. And this is a colonizing plant, so wherever you find one, you're definitely going to be finding more. And as I look around here, I can actually see quite a few coming in, along with a little bit of Dutchman's breeches. Here's another leaf of Carolina Spring Beauty. Here's another. You can see some more of these long, slender Carolina Beauty leaves coming in. Here you can see these are about to start flowering soon. Now this plant has a bulb at the very base of it. It's very small and they're not very deep, so that's kind of nice. As a matter of fact, you can see this one right here. And this is extremely typical. These bulbs, and this is extremely typical of these bulbs to be so shallow. Here you can see the bulb of Carolina Spring Beauty. Really tiny bulb. Now this plant is edible, although I wouldn't waste your time with it. I would just admire the beauty of this plant because its bulb is so tiny and it takes so much to make anything worthwhile. It's not worth destroying the beauty of this plant. I usually don't even like to tear these up just because I think they're so beautiful, but I wanted to show you guys the root for education purposes so you could see, or the bulb so you guys could see what it looks like. If I scrape to the inside, you can see this white, starchy-like core, and that's something you're going to notice if you get to the inside of these bulbs. However, again, like I said, I really wouldn't waste your time with them. They're about the size of a pinky nail. And there you can see my pinky fingernail and the bulb on top of it, and it's almost exactly as big as my pinky fingernail. So these really aren't worth your time. But I'm going to put this back. It's not going to hurt it, actually. It'll just re-sprout from this bulb. That's another good thing about them, is if you leave the bulbs, they're just going to regrow again. And since they're a colonizing plant, there's plenty of them around. You know, I'm probably sitting next to easily next to 50 or so. But I thought I'd show you guys the Carolina Spring Beauty so you know what it looks like and you know what the root looks like, or the bulb. So that way you know not to waste your time with it. The little plant that you see right here is bull thistle. You can tell this in a number of ways. First and foremost is these very, very spiny leaves. You can see these things are absolutely covered in spines. Right now these spines are actually soft because this plant hasn't reached its end size yet. So that's good. You can see these inside ones are still growing nice and firm. Now this plant is edible and it is also medicinal. However, we're not going to get into any of that today, but I did want to show this to you guys. You can see another little one coming up there. But here you can see all of these little spines and all of these little hairs. They are everywhere. And that is why you hear the sound of water running. I'm right here at a confluence of a couple creeks. Here you can see another bull thistle rosette coming in. But as you can see, there are quite a bit of them around. If you just gotta look low to the ground this time of year, everything you're gonna be looking for is right on the ground. I know sometimes you may get a little excited, you may want to, you know, walk real fast and look everywhere, but you've got to stop, you've got to take your time, and you gotta really look low to the ground and pay attention to what's around on the ground. That's one of the most important things about foraging this time of year.
This leaf that you see right here with these very distinct white veins running parallel all to each other, all the way to the very end, this is Puttyroot. This plant is edible, the root of this plant is edible, however, it's not worth harvesting because this plant is extremely, extremely rare. But they're spread out so, they're so sparsely populated that you're not going to find enough to make it worth your time. And this plant, like I said, is very rare. So if you do see this plant, just admire it for what it is. Know that you found something kind of rare, and then walk away. Don't dig it for the root because you're going to kill it. If you kill this plant, you're just causing damage, and that's not the point of foraging. This plant that you see here is broadleaf dock. You can tell this because A, the leaves are very broad. They're slightly wavy on the margins here. You'll also notice this distinct red tinge right here at the base of the stem where the leaf meets. Now, broadleaf dock is edible. These leaves are edible raw. The root is also medicinal. This plant is in the Rumex family, which means it is a relative of buckwheat. Another plant that's in this family is curly dock. Now, you may remember curly dock from my curly dock seed flower pancake. And that's something you can also do with the seeds of broadleaf dock. So that's just something to kind of keep in mind. And this kind of, again, brings credence to the fact that you really want to look on the ground this time of year in the spring or the late winter, because that's where everything that's going to be edible is growing. Quick interruption for some mint. Beautiful flowers here. Can tell it's a mint a couple ways, mainly the smell. Obviously, with any mint, you just rub the stem or one of the leaves or the flowers, and you're going to smell. And after you do that, you're always going to smell some sort of minty smell for the most part. There are some plants that are in the mint family technically that don't smell like mint, so make sure you keep that in mind as well. But for the most part, any of your mints, you're mainly going to smell mint. So if you see a plant that does have a square stem, because that's one of the key identification factors of a mint, is a square stem. However, there are some plants that have a square stem that are not mints that are poisonous. So keep that in mind too. But if you do see a plant that has a square stem you think might be a mint, rub it and smell the leaves, the flowers, the stem. And if you smell any mint, there's a really good chance, like a 99% chance, that it's a mint. See a little fly there getting ready to do some pollination.